Right, guys, I've just been to pick up the twin turntable from Borth, and it's in pretty rough condition, actually. It's in very rough condition, but maybe it needs a clean, I don't know. And we're going to go into Aberystwyth now, and we're going to have part two of the interview with Johny Moris himself. So, taking a bit of a gamble to a certain degree, because I don't know what sort of condition it's going to be in, whether it'll even light up. Bearing in mind, it's been stuck in a shed for goodness knows how long, who knows. But the main thing is, it's got a lot of history behind it, a lot of history. Emperor Roscoe used to use it, you know. We're talking about something that was built in the 70s, and the actual turntables were exactly the same turntables that were used in Radio 1. So, we shall see. Let's have a word with Johny Moris. Right, got a wide-angle lens on again. We're back here with Mr. Johny Moris, spot on disco. Now, that particular deck, as you say, was made in the 70s, and we're going to have a look at it later. It looks a bit rough, but like you said, it needs a damn good clean, doesn't it?
As long as it gets a good clean, you're okay then.
Yeah.
But what happened was Emperor Roscoe, he was doing a lot of outside work, you know, around the country.
Yeah.
And he wanted a good deck, and he knew this fellow called Mac Mathias up in Huddersfield.
Yeah.
Who originated the Orange Amplifier.
Yeah.
And he was the man behind the Matam and the Orange Amplifier with groups.
Okay.
So he had him build three units, one for David Travis, one for Emperor Oscar, and I had the other one, the one that I've
So they are, in a sense, they're virtually unique.
Yeah, they are. There's only three. He wanted something made that was unique and which could be played on any dance floor in the UK. And so Emperor Roscoe then three of them made.
Yeah.
And by Mac Mathias. Because he invented the Orange Amplifier. Cliff, who used to be in London, he was the front man for Orange, and he made this Orange speakers, everything to do with Orange. You still see them with all the big bands now,
right?
All the Orange amplification. He's passed away now, unfortunately, but he's the one who originated the Matam and the Orange amplifier.
When I was here earlier, you mentioned something about someone driving along and someone was shooting tyres or something. What was that?
Yeah, I was working for The Who for a while. And we were down down in the south coast, down Plymouth Way, and we were working in, and they've got very narrow country roads down there.
Okay.
And I went down, I drove Roger Daltrey down there, and a friend of mine was driving Keith Moon. His name was John the Whig, and he had a Bentley, and Roger had a P1800 Volvo sports car suited
right.
up.
Yeah.
And we were playing cops and robbers on the country roads. And Keith was hanging out of the window with a shotgun, trying to blow up our tyres, and I was and they were doing skids around the car.
So literally he was shooting at...
At our tyres, yeah.
My God.
Yeah, and he was trying to shoot, of course. He was so stoned that he kept missing.
And, it's I don't think that's a bad thing, actually.
Yeah.
Well, do you reckon this was a prequel to The Sweeney?
Well, I don't know, but it could well be, because... we had some, I was only 18 then, and we had some great friends, because I was staying with Roger Daltrey up in London, up in Maida Vale, where he had a flat.
Yeah.
And I used to come back and forth to Wales and go back and help him do the driving.
Right.
Because in those days, The Who were just, they were on the point of breaking up.
Okay.
And they were managed by Kit Lambert and Chris Stamp. And of course, so there were big ructions between The Who, and they were all falling out with each other. And the band nearly disbanded, but... it was Roger that kept them all together, fair play to Roger. Roger has worked very hard, and I saw him last year in Swansea doing a show, and talking about the old times, but, you know, he's a very down-to-earth person.
Yeah, he seems it, because he had a stutter, didn't he? But then he very rarely stuttered when he was singing.
That's right, and he had a terrific voice, and his voice seems to have held very well compared to other singers. And one of the original, but he's a hard worker, and he's done a lot of tours of the States, and it's hard work doing all those shows. Well, he was doing about 2 hours, 3 hours on stage, and I saw him in Dallas one year, went down to see him in Dallas, and it's incredible the stamina that he's got.
Right.
And he's always been energetic. He's always been that type of person.
Yeah, I think it's good to do that.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
should get up more and do stuff.
Oh, no, no, I'm past it now. And well, we all find we're all slowing down.
Right.
And, you know, we used to hang around the King's Road in Chelsea a lot.
Okay.
The Chelsea Potter. And some friends of mine, one of them phoned me up the other day, Viv Prince, used to be with the Pretty Things. And I used to be quite friendly with him, and we always used to be around the London clubs. And we used to go down to John Lennon's house a lot in the evening, about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning after being at the Adlib Club in London. And wake him up, and Cynthia would go up the wall, his wife before Yoko. And we used to wake him up, and then we used to have a party there and
right.
down in Weybridge.
So what were the clubs like then?
different to what they are now. The club scene started with the Adlib in London, which was in Leicester Square. You go up on the fifth floor, and you could see the morning break. And they used to sit there. You saw the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, Beach Boys. Everybody used to make for their... And all the groups, when they finished, wherever yeah. they were in the country, to come back to Leicester Square, go up, and we always used to meet there
mm-hmm.
about 1-2 o'clock in the morning.
So
that's a club that used to sort of thrive on superstars.
Yes.
And we were just friends, you know. Rock and roll was just starting then.
So
before the Led Zeppelin days, before all the heavy music days.
Got you.
This was the beginning of the Stones and the Beatles, and we were all young. We didn't know what was happening.
Wow.
And everyone groups. Manfred Mann, all these, they all seem to come back. The Adlib was one of the first clubs in London.
And watch, I'm parked in the yellow line.
Yeah. The Adlib was the first. Then you had the Speakeasy, which another club that opened. Then you had the Scotch of St. James, where we all had our names on the seats.
Yeah, but you know, you say club. Something, again, people who watch these videos, we've got all age groups. We've got yeah. people who are, you know, aged between sort of 90 and dead, and, you know, kids. So, of course, you know, can you do the correct terminology for what was a club then? Because a club nowadays is like loud, big speakers and a DJ.
Yeah. This wasn't loud music at all. It was a class of people that we had there. They were all youngsters. The music was just breaking, and there was a lot of black music coming in, soul music coming into the clubs.
Okay.
They didn't have the music that they have today, the rap music. This was just pure soul music. James Brown.
Is it like Sunday. Northern Soul, Tamla Motown as well? Or
more Tamla Motown. Northern Soul didn't come about till a few years afterwards.
Right.
Because then you had the North of England, which is the Northern Soul area.
Mm-hmm.
This was more sort of soul music. Sam and Dave, Otis Redding, that kind of music. It's
okay.
more...
Chilled and laid back as opposed
yeah,
to full on.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, Northern Soul came very much later. Than the soul.
Got you.
And you used to have the Stax tours. We used to see them all together. They used to do the Rank circuit at one time in the UK. They used mm-hmm. to come up from America, and you see people like Sam and Dave, Old Street, all on the same bill.
Wow.
It was incredible. And they had an incredible feeling. And that was really the start. As people started, everything just started at the same time. What happened was we had a war in the 1947 or 1945. And what happened? People looking for a new way of life. They were looking for new experiences.
Got you.
Our parents were very poor, but it was a new era, and it was just breaking around the 50s to 60s. Elvis started, and I've had numerous talks with Elvis's guitarist and Jimmy, what's his name now?
I'm not sure. Someone will know.
Yeah, he's one of the greatest guitarists in the world. He was with Elvis in Las Vegas, and we've done a lot of work with him. TCB band.
Yeah, where did they play in Las Vegas? Do you remember? Because I know Elvis has probably played everywhere in Vegas.
I think it's the Sands Club.
Sands, right.
Yeah, I think it's the Sands where Elvis played. But we did a show in Denmark a few months ago with them. We recreated Aloha, you know, where Elvis was.
Okay.
And we had all the best Elvises around Europe, and they were backed by the Sweet Inspiration, TCB band, James Burton.
Yeah.
There was James Burton, he was his lead guitarist. Glenn D. Hardy was a fantastic pianist. Ronnie Tutt, who's and he works for lots of the big artists now, fantastic mm-hmm. drummer. And Jerry Sheff was the bass player. They were on, and then there was another fella who said Elvis has left the building. And he did everything for Elvis, cash his checks, everything.
Yeah.
And oh, what's his name now? See, some of these names pass me, but some of the old gang, and we had a great time in Denmark.
Wow.
And these are sort of people we knew. They were with Elvis, and they worked with this fella who did the compere. He did everything, cashed the checks for Elvis, did everything for him. And I Amazing. Never met Elvis, unfortunately. I'd love to have met him, mm-hmm. but I could never afford to go to America in those days.
Yeah, I think times have changed now, but
they right, have, yeah.
I've got to cut this short. All right. All right, this is interview number 2, and if you want any more information or anything like that, then stick it in a comment, and I'll come and have a chat with this guy again. But yeah. Thank you very much. And
right.
Very quickly, you were undisputedly the first mobile DJ here. Do you think you were possibly one of the first mobile DJs in the whole UK?
No, it was just starting then. There were a few around, not many around, when I first started.
Okay, good.
Because Emperor Roscoe was a pioneer of everything to do yeah. with DJing. And because he said, "Hey, Brucey, baby, get that suit going." Yeah, you know, that's how he used to be.
Right.
He had a lot of sort of good...
Full on, yeah. Yeah. It's the spiel, because a lot of people nowadays, they don't use the microphone. They don't.
No,
they don't use a microphone. They sit there with a mouse. Fair enough if you can't get the gear and you're using a PC program or something like that. That's fair enough. But what I find, especially with mobile work, it's good to communicate with the crowd.
That's right.
You get a rapport, and it's not just then the DJ standing there and the crowd, and there's this separation. The microphone, in a sense, is a way of communicating. It breaks the ice.
That's right. And you've got to talk to the people. You've got to get people up on yeah. stage of competitions. When I was a DJ, I just didn't play music. I got people up on stage, I interviewed them.
Brilliant.
Where are you from? And
fantastic.
Joke with them. You never embarrass them, but you
just
talk to them one
yes,
to one.
That's it.
Then you have your music, and it creates an interest. It breaks up, because a lot of people with the dancing, you stop the dancing, you do something like tune a t-shirt or drink a pint of beer
got
or something.
You.
You have a competition. It relaxes the evening. It makes got people
you.
More. Accessible.
Got you.
And people say, "Oh, he's an idiot," or whatever. But you make a fool of yourself on stage. But that's what your job is, to entertain people.
Yeah, exactly.
Nowadays, they just slap a record on, they don't talk, you don't know what they're saying.
Mm. Very
things
true.
Things have changed. And it was fun in those days, because we used to get people, girls coming up, fellas coming up, and they used to have fun, and the audience had fun with them.
That's
it's
right.
It's important to communicate with the people.
Brilliant. That's what I've always said.
People. Yeah.
All right. Johny, thank you okay. very much. Practice and enjoy. Nice
That's
one.
It. Good luck.
Right, guys, before we take a look at the monster over there, take a look at this guy here. Right, this is from American Audio. It's known as the CK1000. It will play MP3s, play CDs, mixer, crossfade, microphone input, CAT. It'll do just about anything. And look at the size of that compared to that guy. Okay. Now this is what I'm on about condition wise. Check it out. You see, what we've got here is we've got the gain outputs for each channel, which is near enough exactly the same as your mixer, but you've got the LEDs, and then logically you've got the master output there. Check this out. Custom built spot on disco by Matt Mathias. Now that is cool. That, on the other hand, is not cool. That is just dirty. I'm hoping I'll be able to get this working. don't know if Johny mentioned, but this, apparently you were able to make the sound move around the speakers, because you could get 4 stacks. Treble, I presume. Bass. Quad pan and normal. You know what? They don't seem so bad. What do you think? This cat's thinking,
yo, this smells really cool.
Let's have a look down the side here. I can't see myself. But what have we got? We've got outputs, headphones, low frequency and high frequency. Check it out, that's excellent. And then on the other side, I mean, that's the base of the unit. I tell you what, it is so heavy. I mean, I had to get a hand getting the damn thing out. So mic input, tape, one tape, two line input, fuses, mains on off. And it's solid. Absolutely solid. Okay. Can you imagine trying to carry that around with you? Well, you know, MP3 players today, you don't know how lucky you are. Yep, bit of a difference in size. Practice and enjoy.